from Acts 21, verse 7 to 17 in the CSB version. When we completed our voyage from Tyre, we reached Ptolemais, where we greeted the brothers and sisters and stayed with them for a day. The next day, we left and came to Caesarea, where we entered the house of Philip, the evangelist, who was one of the seven, and stayed with him. This man had four virgin daughters who prophesied. After we had been there for several days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. He came to us, took Paul's belt, tied his own feet and hands, and said, "This is what the Holy Spirit says. In this way, the Jews in Jerusalem will bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him to the Gentiles." When we heard this, both we and the local people pleaded with him not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul replied, "What are you doing, weeping and breaking my heart? For I am not ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." Since he would not be persuaded, we said no more except, "The Lord's will be done." After this, we got ready and went up to Jerusalem. Some of the disciples from Caesarea also went with us and brought us to Mnason of Cyprus, an early disciple with whom we were to stay. When we reached Jerusalem, the brothers and sisters welcomed us warmly. This is the word of the Lord.
In 1995, a movie was released called Toy Story. And there was a song in that movie from Randy Newman. It sounds like this. I'm not going to sing it. "You've got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead, and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, just remember what your old pal said. Boy, you've got a friend in me. Yeah, you've got a friend in me. You've got troubles. I've got them too. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you. We stick together. We can see it through. Because you've got a friend in me. Yeah? You've got a friend in me. Some other folks might be a little bit smarter than I am. Bigger and stronger too, maybe. But none of them will ever love you the way I do. It's me and you, boy. And as the years go by, our friendship will never die. You're gonna see, it's our destiny. You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me." We're going to talk about the gift of friendship today. Specifically, friendship on mission. On mission, both personally as individuals and corporately as a church. Can I show you our discipleship journey? At Fellowship City, we say that a disciple loves God and loves people. And we are a disciple-making church, so we want to see more of love for God and more of love for people. And to help us to understand how we do this, we say a disciple knows God, a disciple commits faithfully, and a disciple gives generously. And to know how we do that, we have three small dashes under each one of those. Look to the bottom left with me. A disciple commits faithfully to God's people. Meaning, a disciple commits faithfully to be in relationship with other Christians. A disciple also commits faithfully to the mission of the church, because this people, called God's people, are all together on a mission. And friendship matters if you want to stay faithfully committed to these things. If you're old school and you prefer the word fellowship, then that's fine. I'm going to use the word friendship, but you can also say that it's fellowship we are going to talk about today. We are at the last episode in season 3 of the book of Acts. Acts is the origin story of the church, where the church comes from and where the church went and why we are where we are now. We need to study Acts frequently, and then we need to learn from it, and we also need to apply what we learn from the book of Acts for the church here and now, and also for us here and now. So in 2021, we had season 1. 22, we had season 2, we skipped Acts in 23, and now in 2024 we had season 3. Now, we did chapters 13 to 21, and let me just tell you, fam, we only scratched the surface. So I do want to encourage you to make Acts holiday reading. It's one of the best ways to spend time when things slow down and when you are on holiday is to read. Please don't read only news or your reels or whatever it is that comes your way. Read something meaningful. Read the Book of Acts. Why not? It's a great story. In our D group recently, we read through the Book of Acts. We spoke about it. We loved it. And I'm just going to do it again because it's such a compelling story. And let me make a case for you reading it again. Fam, listen to me. We covered 12 years of the life of Paul and more than 10,000 kilometers in 8 more or less 45-minute sermons. There's no way that we could have taught everything there is to know about those 12 years and those 10,000 plus kilometers. Just think about that. Sit down with a book. Read it slowly. Have a highlighter or a pen or something with you. Have a map. And then let the story guide you, inspire you, and just catalyze you to be on mission. Before we jump in, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we are so ready to hear from you through your word. We believe that your word is alive. We believe that your word speaks to us. We believe that your word brings conviction, it brings rebuke, it brings inspiration, edification, illumination. Your word is awesome, Lord Jesus. And we have the privilege of opening it up when we are together. And I pray now that we will learn a lot of you, a lot of ourselves, a lot of our mission, and a lot of this gift of friendship that you've given us. Work in our hearts. Work in our minds. Transform us, Lord Jesus, to be more like you. We pray that in your name. Amen. I am going to play weatherman for a bit. Can we have our map up, please, Rudolph? So, really, really important. Last week, we stopped here in Ephesus. Our teaching text today started down here in Tyre, and it stopped down here in Jerusalem. So what happened between Ephesus with this massive out-and-back road trip of Paul to eventually get there? I can't just skip all of it. I have to read it to you. Here's a summary of what happened in that time. Paul preached. Paul worked. Paul wrote letters. Paul sent people ahead. Paul sent people back. Paul took trips. All of this Paul did with people around him. And you'll see as we work through the text today, the people around him was a team of ever-expanding people. That's the amazing thing. Everywhere Paul went, new people came along for the mission. And the reason why I'm saying that is when we read the book of Acts, we shouldn't skip over names. We often do because it's difficult to pronounce them, but we shouldn't skip over names. We also shouldn't skip over places. We also shouldn't skip over places that tells us where people came from. Because names, places, and where people came from all testify to how amazing Jesus moved his mission forward through people. And when you actually pay attention to all of this detail, you'll see that often Jesus does it in very unlikely ways, or ways that we wouldn't have imagined. The golden thread through all of this work and writing and sending is that through prayer and through the power of the Holy Spirit, Jesus does what he does through those who are willing to say yes and go. That's the awesome privilege about being part of the church. You can say no, but then you won't live. If you do say yes, you'll find life and life in abundance. This is the coolest mission we could ever be on. So until there, just before Paul left from Ephesus to get all the way back to Tyre, he already wrote 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, he wrote Galatians, and he wrote 1st Corinthians. Now obviously, in the book of Acts, we don't find the story, this is where Paul sat down and where he wrote this letter. But I'm telling you this to see that while he's preaching, while he's working, while he's raising up leaders, while he's strategically thinking forward, while he's collecting money for the poor, he's also writing letters. And trying to figure out where the Spirit wants to take him next. It's unbelievable, this guy's work rate. Okay, so I want to catch you up just to make sure that you know what happened between Ephesus and Tyre. I want you to listen closely to names. I want you to listen closely to decisions that had to be taken. I want you to listen closely to timing. I want you to listen closely to Paul's planning, Paul's intentionality, and Paul's focus. This man is on a mission, and he is taking others with him. Paul has deep, deep friendships. Okay, so as I point to the map, let me read Acts 20, verse 1 to 6. It says, after the uproar was over, remember, Lesecho spoke about the riot that happened in Ephesus. Paul sent for the disciples, encouraged them, and after saying farewell, departed to go to Macedonia. So that's Macedonia up there. That's why the arrow from Ephesus goes in a northwest direction. While Paul was there in Macedonia, he wrote 2 Corinthians while he was actually in Philippi. Why? Because he was writing to the church in Corinth to say, I'm coming to collect money. Right? Remember, I told you that I'm going to come and I'm on my way. All through this third journey of Paul, he's been collecting money for believers here in Judea who suffered from severe famine. You guys remember in Acts chapter 12, this same Agabus that we read about today prophesied and said a great famine will come. Indeed, a great famine did come. And because Paul knew that his brothers and sisters in Judea fell on hard times, he said, as I go, I'm going to tell the churches about it, the Gentile church, and I'm going to ask them to support their formerly known Jewish brothers and sisters with money. Okay, so Paul says, these guys are really generous. I just want to tell you about them. I am on my way. I'm coming to collect money. Verse 2. And when he had passed through those areas and offered them words of encouragement, he came to Greece. This is Greece down here. It was called Achaia in that day. And then it says, and he stayed for 3 months. So Paul spent 3 months here in Corinth. Paul wrote Romans while sitting here in this 3 months. Talk about capacity. Have you ever read Romans? It's a masterpiece. And see how Paul thought about it. Phoebe from Kenchrea had to go to Rome, northwest from here, for business. Paul had to take his money back here, but he really wants to go there. So Paul goes, let me write them a letter. And he writes Romans. He gives it to Phoebe. Phoebe is off to Rome, and Paul is on his way back to Jerusalem. That's where he wrote Romans. Talk about strategic thinking. Huh? This guy just never binged Netflix. He never did. He was always working, always looking for opportunities. We'll see it again a little bit later as we go. Now the text says the Jews plotted against him where he was about to set sail for Syria. So he actually wanted to take a straight line, short left, all the way down here. But then it says he decided to go back all the way through Macedonia. And now listen to the names. He was accompanied by Sopater, son of Pyrrhus, from Berea. So Berea is up here. Aristarchus and Secundus from Thessalonica. Thessalonica is up there. Gaius from Derbe. Derbe is all the way down here. Timothy, who came from Lystra. And then Tychicus and Trophimus. I don't know how to say this with the English accent, guys. Sorry, my bad. Tychicus and Trophimus from the province of Asia. We know that Trophimus comes from Ephesus because we read about him in the letter to the Ephesians. Do you see his team? His team's from all over. Isn't it beautiful? These guys know the way. That's why they're accompanying him. These guys know the people here. That's why they're accompanying him. And some of these guys he picked up way back in the day and they are still with him. And then it says, these men went on and waited for us in Troas. So Troas is up here. We sailed away from Philippi after the festival of unleavened bread. So there's Philippi and they came here. And then it says, in 5 days we reached them at Troas where we spent 7 days. Okay, now from verse 7 in chapter 20, there's an amazing story of Paul bringing someone back to life called Eutychus. You must go and read it. It's epic. Then we pick it up again in Acts chapter 20 from verse 13 to 16. It says, we went on ahead to the ship and sailed for Assos, right? So there's Troas and they sailed for Assos. And then it says where we were going to take Paul on board because these were his instructions, since he himself wanted to go by land. Look, it's not really far between Troas and Assos, but Paul goes, you know what, I might just as well go by land. Let's see if I bump into people and there are more people that I can share the good news with. Strategic thinking. Because if we sail around, I might not know what this road looks like, but I've got an opportunity now to travel this road, so let me do it. When he met us at Assos, we took him on board and went to Mytilene, which is down here. And then it says, sailing from there, the next day we arrived off Chios, which is just over there. The following day we crossed over to Samos, which is there. And the day after we came to Miletus, which is really close to Ephesus. For Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus to avoid spending time in the province of Asia because he was hurrying to be in Jerusalem, if possible, for the day of Pentecost. Strategic thinking. He spent 3 years in Ephesus. The moment he sets foot in Ephesus, everyone's going to go, "Whoa, what's up, Paul? Let's hang out, man. Let's light the braai." And also there were people hating on Paul in Ephesus. So he also doesn't want to stir up trouble. So he goes, you know what? I need to be in Jerusalem if I can for the Feast of Pentecost. And then here in Miletus, we get Paul's, listen closely, Paul's only speech directed at only Christians in the whole book of Acts. All of his other speeches and sermons were messages to non-Christians. This one specifically is for Christians, and it is gripping. Read it. Work through it slowly. See what Christian leadership should look like, according to the Apostle Paul. Pray for those in Christian leadership positions, and please also pray for us as your leaders in this church. It's a beautiful, beautiful moment between Paul and the elders of Ephesus. Okay, then, chapter 21, verse 1, we're almost at our teaching text. It says, after we tore ourselves away from them, this is here in Miletus, we set sail straight for Kos, the next day to Rhodes, and from there to Patara. Right, so Miletus, Kos, past Rhodes, headed to Patara. And then it says, finding a ship crossing to Phoenicia, they boarded a cargo ship. We boarded and we set sail. After we sighted Cyprus, passing to the south of it, we sailed on to Syria and arrived at Tyre. There you go. Are you guys all caught up now? And then the teaching texts say, we completed our voyage from Tyre. We reached Ptolemais. And after Ptolemais, we went Caesarea. And after Caesarea, we went Jerusalem. So that's where the apostle is at the moment. I already said it, but let me say it again. Paul preached, Paul worked, Paul wrote letters, Paul sent people, Paul took trips, and he did nothing of this alone. He did this with his friends, an ever-expanding group of friends. One question, four simple answers. Why do Christians need friends? Why do Christians need friends? There you go. We need the gift of hospitality. We need affection. We need prayer. And we need conversations about life decisions. Are you guys with me? Let's tackle the first one. We need the gift of hospitality. Let me just show you one slide. And it's only chapter 21 from verse 7 to 17 with some highlights. Look at it. Verse 7 says, when we reached Ptolemais, we stayed with them. Verse 8, we entered the house of Philip and stayed with him. Verse 16, Nason or Mason, which one is it? You can choose. Can you imagine if my name was Rabino? So which one is it? Reino or Baino? Ah, you can choose whichever one you want. We actually don't know how to pronounce this guy's name. But let's go Mason for now. Mason, with whom we were to stay. Verse 17. The brothers and sisters welcomed us warmly. Verse 4, which wasn't part of our teaching text, literally says, we sought out the disciples and stayed there 7 days. Christians in the book of Acts never said, my house, my home, my place. They didn't. They said, I have received the gift of God, and it's called a house. And this gift of God is meant to bless other people, and it can be used as a place of ministry. And that means that I should love strangers, and I should love new people. So in verse 4, they land and they go, where are all the Christians at? Hey! Hey guys, can we stay with you tonight? Yeah, sure, you're welcome. Do you want something to eat? Let me give you something to wash your feet with. Like, that's how they rolled. That's how hospitable they were. Hospitality in Greek, which is the language in which the New Testament was written, is, it's a combination word. It's philoxenos. Does xenos ring a bell? Xenophobia. Strangers. Others. Hospitality in the New Testament means love for the stranger. Love for the different one. Love for the other. Love for the newcomer. Living in South Africa doesn't help us to love the newcomer. So the church has an amazing opportunity to show this country what real love looks like. I know that xenophobia is alive and well in our country. Can't be in the church. We should be the antithesis of it. We should be the place where everyone is welcome. This hospitality is a requirement for pastors, right? Actually, if you read what qualifies a pastor and an elder, it says he has to be loving strangers and new people. It's also a requirement for all Christians. In Romans 12, Paul says, seek to be hospitable. Look for opportunities to be hospitable. In 1 Peter 4, Peter describes this as a spiritual gift. He says some people just have a gift of being hospitable. And then he says, if you have that gift, do it without grumbling. I like that. Oh, I've got this gift to do this, but I absolutely hate it because it asks so much of me. Paul says, no. Do it fervently and with passion, without grumbling. Why? Here's the simple answer. Because Jesus welcomed us. Period. Strangers and new people we were. Until Jesus made a way for us, we celebrated it at the table this morning. We say the gospel is that Jesus suffered as a substitute for our salvation. He paid the price in our place so that we can be saved. We also say that salvation is you repent of your sins, you receive God's forgiveness, and then you remember the good news, which I just spelt out with these three S's. In the context of the table today, and in the context of hospitality, here's the good news. You who were outside is now inside. Because of His great love, you have been welcomed home. Now, our relationships are so stuffed that if I say home to some of you, it doesn't bring up warm and fuzzies. For some of us it does, right? Home is home. And I know what I feel and I know what I mean when I say it. For some of us, if we say home, it's full of brokenness and struggle and strife. If that's you today, let me rather ask you this question. What do you long for in a home? For us who have good homes, had good homes, and are trying to create good homes, what is it about being home that stirs you? The good news says, your home is now with me. Welcome. That's why at our church we say, we invite you to the table. I want you to use your body and to come home. I had a conversation with a brother this past week, and I said to him, dude, come home. This is home. Your home is now with Jesus. When we practice hospitality, that's exactly what we do. If you would ever visit us at our house, you'll see me do this. Welcome to our home. I do it. Proper job with this body posture and open arms. Because I want you to feel it, man. Because it's our home. Smiles, the whole vibe. We do it when we come to church. I mean, the banner at the gate today as I turned in. Welcome. We have a team who's named the Welcome Team. That's how Christians ought to do it. If we have small little pockets of special moments in our house, like family date night, which is a time set aside for the four of us, you can ask Marie. We sit down at the table and I say, ladies, welcome to date night. And then I explain why this is special. And what we ought to experience is we chow down sushi and watch The Investigators. It's a great series, by the way. Shameless plug right there. It's great to see you. It's great to be with you. And remember, hospitality doesn't have to be limited to your home, right? I know some of us have got really small homes, like hobbits in the Shire. It's okay. If you can't welcome people into your physical home, then you know that you can still show people around, you know. You can still go, welcome to Plato. Welcome to Henny's. Welcome to the mall, if you really want to. You can still do it. You can show people around. You can bring them into your social spaces. Welcome to Fellowship City. Let me take you to the people who I hang out with. I can go on for ages. I'm not going to, but let me just say why I'm stressing this point, fam, because Centurion is a transient area. A lot of people come in and a lot of people leave. And in an area like ours, we need hospitality. Percentage-wise, not a lot of the people in our church grew up here. You moved here, which meant that you had to start over. And that you had to establish new relationships. Some of our families are a little bit more settled at the moment. But you got settled through hospitality and through relationships. Many of us have family living outside our province. Just ask us when it's Christmas time. Everyone's here, everyone's here, everyone's gone. I promise you that the 23rd of December, Fellowship City is gone. We will be back next year, just saying. But it's because people travel to their family. This is an area where you start over and you start afresh and you start new, but very often you are alone. That's why our church needs to be a hospitable church, a church focused on establishing these friendships. You can develop great friendships here. And I can tell you of many encouraging stories in our church, as I even look at you here today, of people who actually became friends. And who found friends and who've grown in their friendship with each other. Love it about our church. It's in our name, you know. Fellowship City. It can be as simple as, let's have coffee or tea together. It's not going to cost you a fortune. It's going to last a good old time. Just start there. We need friends because we need the gift of hospitality. Second one, we need affection. We need affection. Look at the highlights on the screen. So first from Acts chapter 20 and then from Acts chapter 21, both of these scriptures come from outside our teaching text. That's why I'll read it. After he said this, I told you about this awesome time that Paul had with the elders of Ephesus. He knelt down and prayed with all of them. There were many tears shed by everyone. They embraced Paul and kissed him, grieving most of all over his statement that they would never see his face again. And they accompanied him to the ship. I love this. You know the South African way where you say goodbye in the living room? And then you say goodbye again at the front door. And then you say goodbye just outside the front door. And then you, like, there's a quick sprint to the car. But then you don't go straight to the car. It's like just a little bit from the car. And then you say goodbye again. It's actually called Brexit. And then And then you open the door and you sit down and there's like one leg in, but you haven't really said goodbye. And then sometimes that leg comes out and then you kind of stand again. Then you hang on the door. Sometimes you open the window and you shut the door and then you eventually say goodbye. Come on, man. That's the way of Mzansi. That's how we do it. That's how Christians ought to do it. They accompanied him. They walked him to the ship. They didn't get him an Uber. Do you know what I mean? Paul, we'll ask someone to take you. We're quite busy here. No, they walked with him to the ship. Look at Acts 21, verse 5 to 6. When our time had come to an end, we left to continue our journey, while all of them, with their wives and children, accompanied us out of the city. And once again, after kneeling down on the beach to pray, we said farewell to one another and boarded the ship, and they returned home. We need affection. Warning, when I say we need affection, please do not go to awkward and uncomfortable and creepy first in your thoughts. I'm saying that because we live in a hyper-sexualized world. We live in a world that is unfortunately like loaded with physical abuse and sexual abuse. And we live in a world that's increasingly more individualistic, right? If you want to hang out, let's hang out in my DMs. So when I say we need affection, don't go awkward, uncomfortable, and creepy first. Here's what Christian affection is. It's visible. It's appropriate. It's physical. And it's very, very real. All these two scriptures we just read, that's not a fairy tale. That's real people. Real snot and real tears. Oh, sorry. Appropriate way to say it. Snot. My bad. It's real. In the Bible, it's called brotherly affection. So, if you have a good sibling relationship, think of how you show affection to your siblings and then do it to your siblings in Christ. Shoulder to shoulder. Side by side. A pat on the back. A hand on the shoulder. Hugs! You hug your brothers and sisters. You shed tears with your brothers and sisters. You hold hands with your brothers and sisters. Show affection and say affectionate words, fam. This could save someone's life. Because isolation is the name of the game of the enemy in this time. We've said it a gazillion times. Let me say it again. We are more densely populated than we've ever been in history, and we are more lonely than we've ever been in history. How is it possible that you have access to 2.8 million people in the city of Tshwane, but you feel so alone that you wonder if you are still worth living? The enemy has us. If you show someone affection, and you say affectionate words to someone, you might be the very first person who said it to them and who showed it to them in a very long time. Please do not neglect it. Jesus was affectionate with people. He touched people. He spent time like in you can almost smell my breath kind of space with people. And that changed their lives. It changed your life too. The moment you encountered God as being as close to you than your next breath. It's simple. You start by saying something like, it's good to see you. That's an affectionate word. After you've had your conversation around the coffee table or outside at the parking, just say, dude, it was really good to see you. If someone shares something deep with you, just say, thank you for sharing this. I really appreciate that. Hug someone. It's the same as a handshake, you know. The person can reject it. The same way that you do this with your hand to hug someone, to shake someone's hand, you do this with your arms to hug someone. And if it's on, it's on. Make eye contact with people. All of us feel loved when we are looked in the eye. We need this, fam. We need this. And we need friendships, because this happens in friendships. Third one. So we've spoken about the gift of hospitality. We've spoken about affection. Third one, we need prayer. We need prayer. Acts 20, 36 to 38. And once again, 21, 5 to 6. The same highlights we had on. Verse 36, he knelt down and prayed with all of them. Look at verse 5. After kneeling down on the beach to pray. Why did Paul need prayer? Because Paul was on his way to follow in the footsteps of his Messiah to go and die. Paul needed strength. Paul needed to be fortified, to be charged up, to be inspired, to be supported for the mission that lies ahead. And they prayed with him. You need to pray for others, and others need to pray for you. What do we pray for? Well, we pray for God's will to be done in our lives. You don't need someone to send you a prayer request to say, please pray for my marriage, that it will embody God in his full character and look like the story of Jesus in the church. You can just pray for it, for the people you know and the people you love. You can pray for someone's spiritual growth. You can pray for someone to come to Jesus. They don't always have to tell you what to pray for. Pray for them that God's will be done in their lives. People created in his image, destined to be formed in the image of Christ, to be a part of God's family, and to experience eternal life. Sometimes we do actually pray for requests as well, and that's important. People say, will you please pray with me for this decision I need to make? Will you please pray with me for this need I have? Will you please pray with me for these encounters that lies ahead in my life? Yes, I will pray for you for that. That's what these people did to Paul. That's what Paul did to them. That's what Christians are supposed to do. That's what friends do. What are you currently praying for? And do your friends know that you are praying for it? So that they can join you in praying for it. I was really convicted about this week. I love praying for people, and I pray for us, but I'm quite slow to send a message to our friends and go, guys, listen, we have this thing, please pray with us. I was really convicted as I was working through the text and writing the sermon that I should ask more, will you please pray with us and for us? Sometimes we intercede for each other, right? This brother and this sister needs it. I know it, and I just want to make sure that you know it. Please do it now. Intercession is it's a gift of the church to be able to do it for other people. Let's go to KFC. Standing in line. There's a cashier waiting to take your order. 3 or 4 or 5 people in line. Depends on the time of day. Everyone has requests. Everyone has needs. And there's someone who will hear the requests and who will hear the needs. Are you with me? And then all of a sudden, someone comes from the bathroom, cuts in front and goes, excuse me, can I just get in here? And then just starts speaking, looking for the attention of the cashier. Because there's someone in there with a greater need than the dunked wings of the guy third in row. Someone was locked into the bathroom, it's flooding, we need your help now. Please, will you intervene and help the sister in the bathroom? That's how I see intercession. That's what intercession is. Now, I'm not saying there's a row with God and he only takes one request at a time. But when I intercede for people, I feel like you just cut to the front of the line and call the attention of the person who needs to help. And say, Lord Jesus, this marriage is burning. Please intervene. Soften hearts here. Reveal yourself. Shower them with grace and mercy. Help us to speak truth in love. This marriage cannot burn. Please. You see it? It's different than, well, Lord Jesus, you know that at the moment they need to make the decision about school. And there's a lot of things to factor into. So will you please guide them and illuminate their thoughts? Do you see it? There's a difference. I'm not saying one gets God's attention better, but it stirs my heart differently to intercede for people. We need this. So if prayer requests is standing alongside, going to the counter, saying you want dunked wings, and then I say, did you hear that he wants dunked wings? Okay, great. I will have a Boxmaster original recipe fillet meal, please, medium. Are you guys hungry? I am. That's prayer requests. Intercession is cutting the line and begging for help now, please, until it's done, until it gets answered, until it happens. We need the gift of hospitality, we need affection, we need prayer. Last one, we need conversations about life decisions. Let's take a page out of Paul's book here. Look at Acts 19. Verse 21, after these events, Paul resolved by the Spirit to pass through Macedonia and Achaia and go to Jerusalem. I am going to Jerusalem, the Holy Spirit told me. He says it again in Acts chapter 20, verse 22, and now I am on my way to Jerusalem. Compelled by the Spirit, not knowing what I will encounter there, except that in every town the Spirit warns me that chains and afflictions are waiting for me. Verse 24, I consider my life of no value to myself. My purpose is to finish my course and the ministry I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of God's grace. People heard this and they were sad. Look at verse 38 of Acts 20. Grieving most of all over his statement that they would never see his face again. Paul made decisions. He shared those decisions with the brothers and sisters. He was set on those decisions. And look at what happens in chapter 21, verse 4. We sought out the disciples and stayed there 7 days through the Spirit. They told Paul not to go to Jerusalem. Verse 12, when we heard this, both we, this is Luke speaking, and the local people pleaded with him not to go up to Jerusalem. Verse 13, Paul replied, what are you doing? Weeping and breaking my heart. I am ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. 14. Since he would not be persuaded, we said no more except the Lord's will be done. Who's right here? Because one says it's by the Spirit, and the other says it's by the Spirit. So who's correct? We have four perspectives, four groups of people weighing in on this thing that awaits Paul. Agabus comes and he does a little experiential learning with Paul, right? Takes his belt, ties him up. He gives him a prophecy. He doesn't give him a prohibition. Do you guys see it? What's prophecy? Prophecy is making known the will of God. So Paul knows what the will of God is. And the brothers, loving him and really passionate about it, tells him that he shouldn't do it. And then the tiebreaker comes with the prophecy. Agabus doesn't tell him not to go. Agabus just tells him what will happen when he goes. He says suffering awaits him. And for Paul, obedience is more important than opinions. So he was right. And he followed in the footsteps of Jesus. Can I just draw your attention back to Luke really quickly? What did Jesus do in Luke 9 verse 51? It says, he set his face to Jerusalem. What did we just read about Paul? He sets his face to Jerusalem. What did Jesus pray in the Garden of Gethsemane? May your will be done. What did the believers pray with Paul after he showed them, I am not budging. May your will be done. Do you guys remember that there was a prohibition to Jesus? He said, I have to go to Jerusalem to do what? To die? The brother Peter rocks up and goes, no, listen, I just want to say, you actually don't have to go to Jerusalem. We can just stay here for a bit. And then Jesus goes, get out of my way. I have set my face to it. So Paul, in this really important life decision, makes room for people's input. He listens to them. He weighs it up. They have real concern for him. And then he sees the picture even clearer than he's ever seen it. And it strengthens his resolve and it strengthens his obedience. We need that too. We are faced with many decisions, fam. And one of the ways in which you are sure what to do is to talk to people about it. They might have input that's different than your own conviction, but it strengthens your conviction if you listen to their input. It strengthens your resolve. It drives you towards obedience. If you don't talk to people about really important decisions that you need to make, you won't be able to grapple with it with a different voice, and you'll be caught in your own mind, and that might be really overwhelming. I really do believe that if I take all of you one by one now in this service and ask you, how do you make your best decisions? You definitely won't say, 100% on my own with zero input from everyone. You won't. Not even Paul could do it. We need friends because we need conversations about life's decisions. And now we are in Jerusalem. Let's finish off this episode. After this, we got ready and went up to Jerusalem. This is chapter 21, verse 15 to 17. Some of the disciples from Caesarea also went with us and brought us to Nason. Oh, see, I just said Mason earlier, but now it's Nason of Cyprus, an early disciple with whom we were to stay. When we reached Jerusalem, the brothers and sisters welcomed us warmly. And then, stay tuned for scenes from season 4. Amen. As our worship ministry gets ready, let's just walk through the four things we spoke about slowly. We said we need the gift of hospitality. Maybe today the conviction for you or the response for you is, I really need to practice this. I need to seek this out. I need to welcome people. I need to look for the stranger. I need to look for the new person. I need to have coffee with someone. Maybe that's your conviction. Maybe today was the first time that you heard that you are actually welcomed just as you are, and because of the amazing sacrifice of Jesus on the cross, you can be actually welcomed into God's family. Maybe that's your conviction today. That means that you are really, really ready to come to faith and to be saved. We say here at Fellowship City, it's as easy as ABC. Admit your sins. Believe in what Jesus did. You tasted it earlier. And then confess Him as your Lord and Savior. So it's either the Spirit stirring you to practice the gift of hospitality, or the Spirit giving you the gift of the hospitality of Jesus, inviting you in, making it clear to you that you are welcome. You cannot qualify for this table. You cannot be disqualified from this table. When it comes to affection, maybe your conviction is that you need to show more affection to others. Then lean into it and do it in a visible and appropriate and a real physical way. Maybe you really need affection. And maybe today that's your first, the next courageous step is to ask, will you please give me a hug? It's one of the most beautiful things that you can do. Maybe you haven't felt affection from God Himself in quite some time. We looked after my brother and my sister-in-law's baby boy yesterday. Not too sure why I want to tear up now. Yeah, solid. There were many tears. And I had the the privilege again of just having a baby sleep on me. It's so good. It's so good. 45 degree angle, double chin, baby on my torso. And Matthew's arms wrapped around my ribs going, that's affection. When we worshiped this morning, that's where I was. I felt distracted and I felt tired and I just said to God, I just want to be Matty, take me now. Or this is good. This is good. Maybe that's your prayer. Is Lord, shower me with your affection and your mercy. Maybe your conviction is that you really need to ask people to pray for you. Please do it. Every worship service, we end with people there waiting to pray for you. We have a prayer ministry who prays for people, not only according to requests, but also in a spirit of intercession, contending for the lives of our people. Don't go at this alone. Say, will you please pray with me? Maybe your conviction today is that you really need to discuss your life decisions with other people. People who love you and people who can give you sound input to fortify you and to strengthen you. Wherever you land, let me pray for us and then we'll respond in worship. Lord Jesus, thank you for this beautiful gift of friendship. Oh, how much we need this. I'm reminded of the song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. You, once again, Lord Jesus, are the perfect example of what this is supposed to look like. So my prayer is that we would experience your friendship and that we will then embody it for and with others. Help us to practice the gift of hospitality. Thank you for receiving us through the cross. Help us to show affection. Help us to experience yours. Help us to see you pray and intercede for us and then lead us to do the same for others. Lord Jesus, may this community be known for really, really deep friendships that will strengthen us and fortify us for the mission that you've called us to, both individually and corporately. We pray that in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.